As Southeast Asian neighbors Singapore and Thailand pare back growth due to virus disruptions, the Philippines maintains its original GDP forecast, citing relatively minimal impact. With us now for more is Divya Devesh, currency research head for Asia for Standard Chartered. Good to have you back on, Divya. Welcome to the program.
Thanks, Kathy.
So what impact will the forecast downgrades by both Singapore and Thailand have on their respective currencies?
Well, I think if you look at the direct impact of the coronavirus outside of China, I think Singapore and Thailand sort of stand out in terms of having the most negative impact. Thailand, largely from the tourism channel, Chinese tourists contributed almost $18 billion to the economy. Singapore is likely a little bit more diversified in terms of the channels of impact. So it's not just tourism, but also disruption to global supply chain, weak external demand. That should also impact Singapore negatively. But I think, to be fair, markets are already making that differentiation. So if you see the price action for Asian currencies over the past 1 month, Singapore and Thailand have been the worst performing currencies. So Sing dollar and Thai baht have declined somewhere between 2.5 to 3%. But at the same time, markets are also making that differentiation quite clear in the sense that economies or currencies which are relatively insulated or which are a little bit more domestic demand driven have performed much better. So the likes of India or Indonesia or even Philippines. So I think that differentiation has been very early on in this outbreak of COVID-19.
And is that differentiation starting to get clearer, or is there more clarity among investors on how to differentiate what is more exposed and what is not, and where the funds are flowing because of that differentiation?
Absolutely. I think, I mean, if you look at just the price action of the past 1 month, the Philippine peso is actually stronger despite all the negativity around the coronavirus. So I think the view that most investors seem to be taking is first look at which are sort of the more open economies, so the trade-dependent economies, and then you would think about the likes of Korea or Singapore or even Malaysia. Second, they're also making the differentiation to see which economies or which currencies rather provide some sort of yield buffer. So the higher yielding currencies have performed relatively better because, again, we are in an environment where global monetary policy continues to be very accommodative and global liquidity is quite ample, and interest rates in the developed world are at very low levels. So there's still a demand for the higher yielding carry and higher yielding currencies. And again, I think from that perspective as well, the likes of India and Indonesia, which offer 6-7%, have been quite attractive for foreign investors. So I think those are the two parameters with which investors are judging carry and trade openness.
And what about the Philippine peso? I know you've done a scenario analysis, and this is pretty interesting for the Philippine peso. You've done one for good, for bad, and for static. What's the differentiation in those scenarios?
Sure. So a very quick definition of the good, static, and the bad scenarios. A good scenario of coronavirus, which is our base case, is that most of the impact is felt in the first quarter. And by second quarter, we start to see some sort of normalcy, both in terms of trade and tourism. Not a full recovery, but things slowly getting back to normal. The static scenario is the virus basically lingers on for the rest of the year. Not a material direct negative impact, but nevertheless, the concerns still remain and tourism gets impacted. And the bad scenario is, of course, things really get out of hand and then you have a situation where millions of people are getting infected. So I think in a good scenario, the trading range that we are looking at for dollar peso is between 50.3 to 51.3, so roughly a 2% trading range. In a static scenario where the virus just lingers on but does not really create too much damage, we are basically looking at a higher trading range for dollar peso between 51 and 52. And really in a bad scenario, even though we argued that Philippines is not as directly exposed to the coronavirus, I think in a bad scenario, we will really be trading it with a very negative risk sentiment. So risk aversion will be very high, and the demand for safe haven currencies like the dollar will be very strong. So in that kind of environment, mainly because of the risk aversion in markets, you would probably have dollar peso trading much higher between, say, 52 to 53. But again, these numbers are based on sort of some certain assumptions on how the virus exactly
right. plays out. So it's different from forecasts. The scenario analysis is different from the forecast you have for the first quarter and the second quarter. So where do you see dollar peso headed?
Exactly. In our base case scenario, we do think some sort of recovery happens by the second quarter. So I think markets will go back to trading the fundamentals for peso. And the way we have sort of characterized 2020 is that peso's fundamentals are deteriorating, but at a very gradual pace. So the forecast that we have, quarterly forecast for the rest of the year, 50.5 for Q1, 51 for Q2, and then 51.5 for Q3. So you would probably see it's a gradual upward sloping forecast trajectory for dollar peso. The reason why we have a gradual depreciation of peso penciled in our forecast is primarily three things. One, real policy rate in Philippines is declining, i.e. inflation is picking up while the BSP is cutting rates. Second, current account deficit is likely to widen in the Philippines. So we are looking at a current account deficit of 2.3% this year from a much lower level last year, 2019, which we think was close to 1.6%, largely driven by higher infra spending and higher capital goods imports. And third, I think purely from a valuations point as well, if you look at the Philippine peso real effective exchange rate, that has rallied almost 10% in the last 2 years. So the peso seems quite strong at these levels. So all three factors together, I think we'll probably see a gradual depreciation of the currency through the course of the year.
All right. Well, thank you so much for the assessment there and giving us some clarity. We'll keep tabs of your forecast. Divya Devesh of Standard Chartered in Singapore.